America's landscape is littered with lighter fluid, and the media refuse to stop throwing burning matches. Now, what will actually ignite a true civil war?
And now, The Edwin Black Show. Sponsored by the books of Edwin Black, available on Amazon and at booksellers worldwide. And now, here's Edwin.
Welcome to the Edwin Black Show. I'm Edwin Black, investigative journalist and historian and author of IBM and the Holocaust, War Against the Weak, Financing the Flames, and many other books. If you like what this show is doing, tell a friend. Subscribe for passwords at theedwinblackshow.com. It appears we have viewers today from across America. I still see strong viewership, as always, in Florida and Michigan, but today also Nevada, California, and Georgia, plus our overseas viewers. In addition, we acknowledge our watch parties that multiply our audience. The Edwin Black Show is growing globally. We speak to a fragmented world, seeking better understanding of our tormented past, our present very tense, and a future still uncertain. Now, for today's frightening episode, can it happen? 2 years ago, people would have laughed at those who spoke of a second civil war in America. But long ago, I saw one over the horizon, gathering steam. In mid-2019, I warned friends in a chat group, quote, after the November 2020 election, numerous unrelated, loosely related, and clearly connected troubles are and will continue to boil over and coalesce. I fear and hope that I am wrong, but we may see a well-armed and more often street-armed and splotchy civil war that pits tribe against tribe, interest against interest, jurisdiction against jurisdiction, state against state, city against city, and military group against military group, as well as red against blue, unquote. Today, no one is laughing at such ideas. More and more people are asking if it is possible, and they're asking in both public and private forums, from chat rooms to network TV. How would such a conflict look? What can accelerate it? What can slow it down? Make no mistake, a second civil war in America would be a nightmare of dislocation and destruction that would take a generation or more to undo. I speak as a historian who has studied civil wars and social unrest across the centuries and in many countries. The historian's mission is to use the past to confront the future. Don't do this, America. Face it, the country has been split into idea silos, so tightly wrapped that it is now almost universally agreed that we already have a civil war, that is a cultural civil war, a platform civil war, an irreconcilable political and idea civil war. But what I am talking about is the potential for more than a shouting war. I feel the shooting war is the one that we must avoid because it will tear this country apart, not into two pieces, North and South, as in 1861, but into many shreds. Zone against zone, urban against rural, family against family. Everyone agrees that there seems to be irreconcilable differences between the two political halves of our nation. But each day the conflict is escalating into more and more physically threatening dimensions. Everyone has seen our cities undergo destructive waves of mass looting, rioting, arson, Seattle-style occupation zones, hate attacks, and hyper-escalating crime waves as a byproduct of the radical political unrest. Increasingly, the targets are anyone who disagrees with anyone. Persuasion and conversation is out. Now intimidation and ruination is in. Permissive violence and harassment is in and seen daily. Permissive violence means many people now feel they have a license to harass and intimidate. As the intimidation escalates into actual violence or the fear of actual violence, tensions rise. A pot of cold water can heat up 1 degree at a time until it boils over into a scalding brew. Throughout history, verbal violence invariably leads to physical violence. It's not just the downtowns and commercial districts being looted or burned with an air of entitlement and impunity. We have seen the destruction from the struggling ma and pa stores in the neighborhood to Rodeo Drive outside Hollywood. We are now way beyond that. Increasingly, people are harassed in their homes. That St. Louis couple that went for their guns was threatened by agitators at their gate who promised to seize their home. In other ordinary residential neighborhoods, agitators have walked down the street late at night, around midnight, with drums and noisemakers telling people to get out of their homes and to get into the streets. You don't need 10 more examples. You've all seen the videos. Notice, by the way, I'm not calling these people protesters. I'm calling them agitators. So how did we get here? We start with silos. Digital and other platforms have fostered realms of people talking to each other about what they agree on instead of engaging in the free exchange of ideas to find compromise and improve. Silos create echo chambers. Silos also create mobs. From mob psychology, we get the encouragement of escalation. From escalation comes threats. There are those who make the threats and those who feel threatened and react, which just feeds the fission. Threats inspire fear. Fear spawns hate. Hate percolates into physical violence. Who do I blame the most? The media. A responsible media is indispensable to a freedom-loving democracy. In America, the media has completely abandoned its duty to provide diligent, impartial, and balanced coverage. Worse, the mainstream media found a rewarding economic model in keeping the country in a frenzy with scare tactics, fake news, selective coverage, blowing the small stuff into overwrought, explosive headlines, censoring the really important news, and consciously feeding misleading and openly false info. They have shredded all earlier journalistic standards. The use of the standard term allegedly has been replaced with the pseudo-authoritative false, or the bias trigger phrase, without any evidence. The concept of simultaneous rebuttal, where the journalist must call the person he's covering to get their side of the story, that has been shredded. The media right now loves chaos. In other words, the media stokes the fires and keeps us crazy so they can sell pharmaceuticals, furniture, and pillows. It's a lucrative business plan. And they chose sides, becoming not just reckless media, but partisan media. More than that, the anchors and reporters are now believing their own sputum to be holy water. It gets worse. The more people rejected the partisan media and lined up to either oppose or support Donald Trump, the more vitriolic, self-righteous, and outlandish the mainstream media became. Sensing their own irrelevance in achieving a goal outside their echo chamber, the media turned up the volume, screamed louder, abandoned all caution, and disgraced their own profession. Eventually, CNN, MSNBC, Fox, and the major newspapers began regularly attacking each other, accusing their competitors of gross misconduct. What's more, the media fostered their own tribal audiences. I've been in homes that vehemently will not permit either Fox or CNN or MSNBC to air, and that can make a problem when visitors come and want to see their favorite programs. Know this, we can expect political, social, and economic misconduct in our country. That is history, and it is a given of the human condition. But it is the media's role to provide fearless clarity, balanced information, analysis, and fact-anchored insight as the magic ingredient of social stability. That role was self-immolated in favor of the chaotic mess we have today. Half the country is just tired of being under attack, and they have lost their faith in what they hear. I call it the Pravdaization of the media. Pravda means truth in Russian, and it was also the name of Stalin's state propaganda newspaper. You see, it was the Orwellian irony of a newspaper called Truth being widely considered a sheet of lies by its own readership. That was Stalin, and that is coming to the United States. No one knows what to believe. Rumors and tweets are now elevated to reliable information as the country twists and turns. I recently spoke of the death of journalism, and I'll be talking more about that in future shows. Since this election, so many people have come out to say this conclusion: they can't believe anything the media tells them. The confusion has become all the more chaotic because now social media is not only censoring private information, but they're also censoring official agencies and even media organizations. Not only has Twitter censored the president, Senate committees, and Customs and Border Enforcement, Instagram put a warning label on Fox Business's Maria Bartiromo's promo message about a forthcoming interview with the president. One America News was deplatformed for a full week, but at a crucial electoral moment, Twitter blocked the entire account of the New York Daily Post, founded by Alexander Hamilton and the fourth largest newspaper in the country, for a truthful expose of Joe Biden and Hunter Biden's scandalous financial dealings in China, which was corroborated by other independent journalism and video testimony and has become virtually validated by the sheer fact that the Bidens have never denied the evidence. Now the media has dangerously descended into revenge journalism, proliferating public calls for one half of the country to seek revenge on the other half that voted for, worked with, legally represented, donated to, or otherwise engaged with the Trump administration. Here we see the Columbia Journalism Review, Washington Post, New York Times, CNN, and others amplify the calls for revenge, ostracism, and economic bankruptcy against opponents. This forces people to think about protecting their futures and their families, and they do so with the fight or flight option. Everyone is on edge, and too many on edge, and too many on each side believes that if the presidential candidate they oppose fails to take the presidency, the country cannot stand. Many months ago, the Democrats ran war games on this election under the aegis of the Transition Integrity Project. It mapped out numerous scenarios of how to respond if Donald Trump was elected or failed to accept legitimate defeat. The options were, among others, to rally known friends in the press to amp up the pressure, call people into the streets to riot, partner up with the military. In one major scenario, if Donald Trump were to win fair and square, Democratic leaders in this war game organized a succession of three largely Democratic West Coast states, Oregon, Washington, and California, into a new breakaway country called Cascadia. Hence, the Democrats have actively been examining the concept of a civil war for months. Now, the pandemic has taken every problem and geometrically worsened it. The media did its best to falsify, distort, misreport, and make impossible fair coverage of the facts and progress of the disease and America's response. Look at ABC and NBC Evening News last week. They both falsely, in a complete lie, reported that President Trump said distribution of the vaccines would begin within a week, adding that the CDC made clear the president was lying. The president stated the distribution would begin, actually what he said was,
"We are rounding the curve. The vaccines are being delivered literally. It'll start next week and the week after."
ABC and NBC cut out the words "or the week after." Even still, 3 days later, the media was filled with stories about United Airlines flying charter flights across the country to pre-position millions of doses across the nation. So when the green light is given by the FDA, the vaccines are already local and distributed. 1 week later, the media is now filled with coverage of that very distribution. ABC and NBC deliberately lied to reduce good news to the public and continue to invalidate the faith half the country has in their president's statement. There is a reason why in the Ten Commandments, commandment number 8 declares, thou shalt not bear false witness. The holy books consider libel and defamation to be the only sin which cannot be adequately compensated. Not even an eye for an eye can make amends, because a bell once rung cannot be unrung. This is all going somewhere. It's not just the media. It's that the American public are now losing confidence in all their institutions. COVID-19, the electoral mess, the lockdowns, the justice system itself, sports, cultural traditions, religious freedom, and of course, all the economic dislocation. It's crushing our unity. Pay attention. America's landscape is littered with lighter fluid, and the media refuse to stop throwing burning matches. Now, what will actually ignite a true civil war? That is, when will ordinary people feel the threats to their families and themselves so substantial that hotheads on either side could be provoked into a defense action wherein people will actually take up arms? Number one, if Trump overturns the election result by either a Supreme Court ruling or a successful challenge to the Electoral College, you are promised riots in the streets. Number two, if the Trump revenge establishment led by the Trump Accountability Project and various media outlets starts to actually exact retribution, such as convening a Rwanda-style Truth and Reconciliation Commission, as suggested by former Clinton Labor Secretary Robert Reich, you will see it. Here Biden must, and I repeat must, condemn these revenge programs. He preaches unity, but he has failed to speak up about these revenge projects. And the media again fails. Whereas Trump was continuously asked to condemn white supremacy and it was never enough, Biden is never asked to condemn the Trump Accountability Project or a range of revenge advocates. So I will ask him right now, please speak up, Joe Biden. Number three, if the progressive wing of the Democrats secures enough power to enact their program of confiscatory asset taxes, suburban makeovers, or dissolution of neighborhoods, thereby drastically changing people's way of life. This will include riotous home invasions or property incursions. People may take action. Number four, if COVID-19 lockdowns, which seem all the more nonsensical to many, triggers a riot, well, that could have a chain reaction. Remember, these are unlegislated, undiscussed, capricious, and inconsistent, sometimes from one block to the next, as we see at a Staten Island restaurant, which has now been declared, as of an hour ago, an autonomous zone by protesters. Democracy requires the consent of the governed. What we see here is monarchical rule. And of course, salt is rubbed in the wound because too many of the mayors and governors making these oppressive closures have been caught traveling, dining out, partying, and otherwise hypocritically violating the rules they want everyone else to observe. The Arab Spring started because just one fruit stand seller went berserk out of despair. It is true that gun sales since March 2020 have increased by millions over prior years, but if we ignite into insurrectional skirmishes, it will be led not by good and average people taking up arms. It will be led by extremists on the left and the right, Antifa and many allied groups on the left, and the Proud Boys and various flavors of neo-Nazis spoiling for a fight. Then average people will have to figure out where they stand. I say to all, beware of red hats and black helmets. Beware of hijacked slogans such as Make America Great Again and Black Lives Matter. A few days ago, I watched a skilled agitator exhorting a crowd of Trump devotees with all the usual slogans. I waited for it, and the red-hatted agitator finally delivered. His slogans slowly turned anti-black, anti-immigrant, and then he said America was only for the followers of Jesus Christ. Innocent Trump followers were being bamboozled by this guy. No one even knows if he was really a Trump supporter. I have a lot more to say, but we have so many questions pending, and my thoughts, I think, will actually emerge in my responses to those questions. Number one, Renee from the Villages. What would a civil war look like on the ground? Response, Renee? Checkpoints and autonomous zones would spring up, like we saw in the Seattle CHOP, but they could involve a whole county. They might take names of people coming their way. They might ask people to sign information, but I think this will be the first sign. And we've already seen actions like this taking place in different places in different ways, which I think will come out in our next questions. Thank you, Renee. Cynthia in Youngstown, Ohio, I guess. What did you mean when you said jurisdiction against jurisdiction? Well, in California, we saw four sheriffs right now who have said they will not enforce Governor Newsom's latest lockdown orders. One guy said, I'm not going to criminalize people having dinner in their own home. Earlier this year, we had police in neighboring states going door to door looking for New Yorkers. Other states began to do out-of-state searches for people from Florida, Connecticut, et cetera. If there is an insurrection, we will see a patchwork of authority being asserted and rejected. At every corner, individuals will have to figure out under whose authority they will respond. Here's one from San Francisco, Wes. To avoid the shooting war, do we not need the ragged and raw debates, many coming from the shouting war? Are we already beyond shouting? That is the question, Wes. Are we beyond the shouting? Right now, we are shouting. We are having these raw conversational or non-conversational conflicts. But at some point, something is going to blow up. And when that blows up, it'll be like a chain reaction. This is from Christine. How do we heal? We're not going to heal. We can survive. And once we survive, we can approach the concept of healing. We need to coexist. We need to come together as a country. I want us to come together as a country. But all this talk about healing is just lip service when you have people on the right going out into the streets. Like I saw a video in Sacramento, California, looking for trouble. And you have people with this Trump accountability project. It's the fear that will not help us, not permit us to heal. And therefore, if we can subtract the fear, if we can reduce the fear, we have a better chance of discussing the concept of heal. Here is another one from San Francisco, complimenting my comments. And consider these that these people in the media are true believers in everything they say. How is it possible to put a check on this democracy-killing trap that we're in, given the manipulation of news and reality operates at an emotional level? You know, so many people scoffed, me included, when Trump said the media is the enemy of the people. But when the media is now calling for half the country to take revenge, ruinous revenge on the other half of the country, when some of the media are completely lying or subordinating the truth about what happens, when we have the Abraham Accords, which is an extraordinary thing that occurred with Bahrain and the United Arab Emirates flying into the lawn, and that rated nothing more than a short reader in the middle of a newscast, when you have some 63% of the Biden voters, in according to one poll, saying they never heard of Operation Warp Speed and they might have voted differently, when you have some two-thirds of Republicans saying they believe the election was rigged. Now you're talking about 50 million Americans. When you're talking about a majority of Democrats who believe that Trump rigged the election in 2016 by working with the Russians, we have a long way to go. And the people stoking this are the media, and they're picking up the rent. Denton in Washington, D.C. Could technology create the spark? The spark, I guess, the Civil War. If the internet or the power goes down, even for an hour, people could panic. If it goes down for a day, the panic could be out of control. Watch for that. That's why I've invested in lots of batteries and battery packs so I can recharge my phones and some of my machines. Here's another question. Renata in Newton, it's another one of our watch parties. Renata said, what do you know about Newsmax or One America News? The vacuum of truthful and reliable and trusted media is shifting people's eyeballs into second-rate, third-rate, and fourth-rate media operations like Newsmax and One America News, and even news organizations that do not normally report this stuff, who are specialty. And those groups are seeing such a surge in their following. In the case of Newsmax, they went from 60,000 a day before the election to almost 1 million a day right after the election. And they ramped up everything. They've improved and they're developing and they're now trying to get better. So people are looking for answers. The rebirth of journalism will not be done in weeks, will not be done in months. It will take years to build organizations, to build truth, to build circulation, proliferation. And remember, it's got to be somebody more than just somebody who repeats stuff they see on the internet. We need finders of fact, challengers of fact, confirmers of fact, people who go down to the legislature, people go down to the board meeting, people who go down to the FDA, people who actually ask the questions on the ground, Associated Press, Reuters, people like that. Shelby in Madison, I guess it's Madison, Wisconsin, wants to know if the media is dead, what will take its place? We don't know. In the short term, it's up for grabs. What will take its place? Everybody's looking for information. They're getting stuff on the email. They're getting stuff on WhatsApp, on Facebook, on all these different modalities. And they're wondering. I saw something strange the other day that was being repeated throughout the echo chambers, saying that there was a firefight in Germany to get a secret server and bring it back here. Totally unsubstantiated. And by the way, if you are me, I'm getting information from the left, the right, and the center almost once or twice a minute with information that has to be validated or invalidated. Jules in San Francisco. All right, Wes, there's another guy in San Francisco. He says, could Trump lead a civil war? Will he run for office in 2024? Anyone can start the civil war, and it will probably be led by someone whose name we do not know in some circumstance we cannot predict. Will Trump run for office in 2024? Absolutely not, because I believe state prosecutors will do their utmost to put him in jail. And he knows this. And the Southern District of New York is leading the pack. Norbert in Cincinnati. Is Soros paying for a new crop of prosecutors? Is this true or more fake news? It's true. I recently investigated one of the Soros foundations, one of the new justice foundations that he's got there, giving enormous amounts of money, hundreds of thousands of dollars to local prosecutor races. This program put Kim Fox into Cook County, Chicago. She was the one who let Jesse Smollett off, the prosecutor who went after the St. Louis couple who waved their guns when they felt they were under siege. She is one in where a great deal of money was put in, and it is all of this type of bringing unknown people with a brand new concept of justice into power. It's being done each and every day. Max in Manhattan. So are we or are we not going to have a real civil war? 51% we are. That's the best I can guess. That's just a guess. Here's from Ken in Florida. In Palm Beach. Does Trump have the power to declare the use of Dominion voting systems and related software is illegal in any election in the United States? I think he actually could do this in a certain way. It's an interesting question, but it wouldn't affect the 2020 election. It might affect the 2022 election. And maybe the better question is not whether Trump will run for president in 2024, but whether Trump will run to be a member of the House of Representatives in 2022. I think that's a much more likely proposition. Here's somebody called Ellie. Oh, she's in New York, she says. You are spot on. How can we go back to agreeing to disagree civilly and not with condescension and horror? Once again, the media needs to set the example of a proper tone of discourse. And it's not supposed to be one of these food fights that Fox and CNN have, where they have five liberals and one token Trump guy, or four Trump guys and poor Juan Williams on the five on Fox. That's just more circus action. We need to see a real tone set. People's credibility needs to be restored. I think we're beyond that. You know, credibility is hard to secure, but easy to lose. Easy to lose. Here's another one from New York. I'm so incredibly tired of the never-ending political discussions, the firing up, the media, and that includes Fox, never let up. That includes discussion of the pandemic. Is there anything we can do? At this point, having been in the media for 52 years, having done the hard stuff, the easy stuff, and the medium stuff, having been on the street and at the editor's desk, I don't have an answer. I myself am looking for a way to get cogent information. I think you need to have a large grain of salt, perhaps maybe a pound of salt for everything you hear, and then make the effort to get it confirmed. A lot of people are likening the news you get now to spam, but you have to check it out, or potential spam. When I saw what ABC and NBC did, totally lying about the president's words, when I saw that the Abraham Accords was relegated to just a small reader in the middle of the broadcast, when I saw complete actual censorship of the Hunter Biden scandal, right or wrong, I knew that we had crossed a threshold and it'll be very difficult to get back. Here's another one from Northern California. The COVID mess is, I believe, on Trump for failing to develop a coherent national plan and strategy, lacking to this very day, and that would have put one uniform set of rules on the entire country. Let's just take that. That's just not possible, San Francisco. We are not Sweden. We are not France. We are not South Korea. We have 50 states. We have a federal system. We have a vast continent. We have 3,200 counties. And as I said in the previous show, and each of those 3,200 counties has its own unique characteristics. If you're going to ask people in the middle of downtown Philadelphia to wear a mask when they go outside, fine. But do you ask the same of a rancher in Western Kansas? Do you ask the same of a cowboy in Montana out on the open range? Do you ask the same of people where in rural settings or in small towns? So there's not a balance. And we do need specific guidelines. We need the guidelines. Sometimes these guidelines are sounding crazy to us because there's a guy in Staten Island right now who is not allowed to serve food in his restaurant. There are people protesting right now, a crowd of people demanding that he open up. He was arrested. One block away, there's another bar serving the food. People can't understand why they can go to Costco, hundreds of people in the store, they can go to a strip club, they can go to a liquor store, but they can't go to church. When people say, oh, just 10 people can go in the church, but the church is a cathedral that seats 1,000 people. This all seems arbitrary. And so I don't think it's on Trump. It's true, he was not perfect, but no one could be, because I'll never forgive Dr. Fauci in February and March for saying people should not get a mask. And I will also say that if it weren't for Operation Warp Speed, which has been undercovered, you wouldn't have three vaccines ready for approval right now, one of which yesterday was already approved in the UK, the Pfizer vaccine. You wouldn't have tens of millions of doses being flown right this minute, waiting for the FDA to give the green light. So as soon as they give the green light, it's already in New York City. It's already in Houston, Texas. It's already in California. It's there now, or it'll be there in a couple of days. All that occurred because of Operation Warp Speed, as well as these travel bans that I've spoken of. Here's another question. Don't you agree when fake news and science gets mixed for whatever motivation, bad things happen? COVID is the most recent horrible example of the consequences of this. California, I've spent a career, 52 years, clearing up false impressions, excavating information, shocking people with the documented and verified truth. And one of the most important things that I have discovered as a result of my investigations of medicine and public health was never rely on the experts. Let me say it that way. They always say, rely on the experts. Let the experts decide. Experts should never make policy. Why? Because the experts disagree. The experts change their minds. The experts can be influenced. The experts are often corrupt. When you have spent as many years as I have investigating genocidal men of medicine in the Third Reich, in the Soviet Union, in Romania, in the United States, in the eugenics movement, you have learned to listen to the experts with a great big pound of salt and let the elected governance make the decision between the expert advice among the experts and the realities of what is and is not possible. I don't expect Dr. Fauci to understand military matters and to understand how the military intends to distribute these vaccines. And that's why only the commander-in-chief or the president or the prime minister can make these decisions. Here's another question here. The media disease appears to be contagious worldwide. I have family in Germany and Switzerland and in Israel, which is very left-leaning, and keep hearing how the media is almost totally in lockstep, all demonizing Trump. Even the relatively neutral and serious papers have gone over to repeating what America media puts out or even more. Now, that's funny. I've got a similar question right here from France, from someone in France. It's not you. Her name is Florence, and she says the same thing. And apparently, let me address this. This happens, this type of thing that we have seen here happens in Europe. You have party media, you have state media, you have all these different media and government-sponsored media, and they can't be trusted. We had here in the United States, let's say for about 50 to 100 years, the golden age of journalism. We set the standard. We were the gold standard. And that's all been obliterated. And it wasn't by accident. It was consciously by the media. Now I'm getting another comment here. Here's somebody in Fullerton who's apologizing because they have to get back to work. Polling is not intended to be predictive. It is intended to sway the outcome. That is the whole point. Yes, that's important. The way the false polls were deployed this time, on top of last time in 2016, it is clear that they were intended as propaganda tools. That was one of the main ingredients in why people have lost faith in the polls, in the grand media that sponsored these polls, proliferated these polls. It just feeds into the fact that people don't know who to trust. It makes people ripe for instigation, ripe to escalate the sense of threat. Somebody threatens you and you feel more and more vulnerable. This is not a question of left and right. This is a question of, can we get along? And we cannot get along as long as the media makes sure we don't get along. And what are we going to do about it? We don't know. I don't have that answer for you. Here is Howard. I don't know where Howard's. Oh, he's in Maryland. Could a civil war lead our strategic adversaries, China, Russia, Iran, to take actions that they wouldn't even think about normally? Yes, the answer is absolutely yes. And so there's a parallel universe going on here. While we're all discussing this civil war and waging a war of words that may soon escalate to a shooting war, there's a whole universe of people in our country, in the military establishment, who are making sure that we do not let Iran commence any attack on the United States' interests. We just now have closed down our Baghdad embassy just a few hours ago, fearing an attack. We have to get the message to North Korea. There's a real probability that there will be an American bomb attack on the Iranian nuclear facilities, either solo or in some form of support or in conjunction with Israel, Saudi Arabia, probably even the UAE. I'm not giving anything away that I know specially, which I do have special information. Everyone is talking about this. But if Trump orders such a bombing or other attack, and it will not just be one surgical attack, many things would have to be destroyed and neutralized in order just to bomb the enrichment facilities in Iran. Will the military cooperate? Now, the military in the past week or two has been totally changed. Esper is out. The National Security Council has been switched over. We've got new chiefs of staff. We have people like Madeleine Albright, believe it or not, and Henry Kissinger were removed from the National Defense Policy Board. We even have Trump threatening to veto the military appropriation that's pending right now if Congress does not immediately and simultaneously repeal 230, robbing Twitter and Facebook and the others of its immunity. I've got a lot more questions and I can't take any more because we're out of time. So I'll see everyone next week at 3 p.m. Eastern. We're going to have a full panel again of some very important people. You'll find out soon. Until we meet again, head over to any Barnes & Noble in the USA or any Amazon platform in 190 countries across this planet, where you can find any of my 200 book editions, such as IBM and the Holocaust, War Against the Weak, and Financing the Flames. Get passwords and access to participate live in our future shows. Go to theedwinblackshow.com. You'll see, as I said, a much enhanced and produced version of this show and prior episodes by subscribing to our YouTube channel at The Edwin Black Show and click that notification button. Follow me at Edwin Black Book on Twitter and Facebook. Want to join our show production group? We could use the help. Email me, join the team at theedwinblackshow.com. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm zooming out. Thank you for attending a very special episode. I'm getting so many comments even now. Goodbye.